Blackstone Publishing presents Hell, a Novel by Kathryn Davis. This book is read by Elisabeth Rodgers. For my sister. My dear, oh dear, it was an accident. W.B. Yeats. Something is wrong in the house. Of course, you're dismayed. You have every right to be, for haven't you followed the rules to the letter, ridding your rooms of all corruption, the mite-infested cheese, the fly-blown mutton, the sour bed linens, the dung-caked boots? You've sponged the floors, beaten the rugs, hung rue at the threshold. A fire is burning briskly in the kitchen, a pudding chilling in the pantry on its bed of ice. Yet how can it be that when you permit yourself a moment's relaxation, standing at the window you washed only yesterday, its panes don't reflect back the bright prospect of a clear conscience, but the treacherous face of the world? And what's the use, really, if you can no longer tell the difference? What's the use if you can no longer tell where your face leaves off and the gray sky begins? Raindrops stream down the window, ruining your hard work. That yellow-haired girl peeking from between the trees on the other side of the mill race, spying on a delicate yellow leaf caught trembling in an eddy. Can that be poor Joy Harbison? Or is it some other lively figment, anachronism or memory, ghost or invention? In the beginning, we're told, everything was the same. Everything was locked together inside a huge lump of ice. But soon enough, the ice began to melt, and because it was too huge to notice the moistly fraying hem of itself, threads of milky, silt-filled water unraveled across the landscape, slowly at first, then fast, faster, setting the miller's wheel in motion, thundering toward a future where a little yellow leaf was sweeping over the lip of the dam. Rain was falling from a sky that spectral shade of gray that's almost white, dispiriting, and I was sitting at my father's bedside, eating fries out of a paper bag. "Something's wrong," my father was saying to my mother. "I can feel it in my bones. Did you turn off the stove? One of these days you're going to burn down the house, Dorothy." "Eat your lunch, Edwin," she replied. Ever since his stroke, my mother had been on top, but now my father was going to get the upper hand by starving himself to death. Out the window, mountains, clouds, a landscape as featureless and vast as the hospital room we were in was cramped and populous. Out the window, nature. And is that where you're headed when you're dying? Or is it the afterworld as crowded as Napoleon's table at Malmaison? Beautiful women, jabbering men, Antonin Carême's brilliant pyramids of food. In my father's room, there were white takeout bags on the bed tray, fries and soft drinks and burgers, though it hardly mattered to him. After the stroke, he could only see half of everything, his plate, his hand, his face. The moral vision, similarly bisected, becomes strangely severe.
"Gold will suffer," my father said, "but it will serve him right. That poor little kid. Whatever happened to her?
Little Blondie. You know the one I mean," he said, letting out a long, slow whistle while pointing over his shoulder with his thumb, a gesture we all knew meant flew the coop. "When it's no longer your job to carve the empire, rule the kingdom, balance the scales of justice, often the best position left open is that of prophet."
"He'll turn to salt if the earthworms don't get him first," my father added.
X marks the spot. "I haven't the faintest idea what you're talking about, Edwin," my mother replied. Out the window, the town of X. All the houses haunted, even the meanest of them. For it's common knowledge, misery breeds tenacity. Just ask my mother. The houses haunted, and the pond perfectly smooth, except near the dance pavilion where someone has just stood, wobbled for a moment, dizzy, to wade through the sickeningly hot water at the pond.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.